From the historic Ebell Theatre in Los Angeles, California, ladies and gentlemen in the audience, as well as our thousands of internet viewers worldwide, we'd like to now invite you on a time travel where we will bend time, twist perceptions, and put a new spin on the future with our guest performers, esteemed judges, and the 2013 winners of the L. Ron Hubbard Writers and Illustrators of the Future contests. Please welcome Kimberly Locke, who will perform an original anthem inspired by and for artists everywhere. She is joined by characters from the winning stories now published in L. Ron Hubbard Presents Writers of the Future, Volume 29.
Yeah. The L. Ron Hubbard Writers and Illustrators of the Future contests have become an invaluable institution in the field, discovering important new talent, and both contests are still growing. When I was starting out, the contest gave me a goal to shoot for. Prize money, trophy, recognition, and most of all, the chance to participate in a marvelous writing workshop. The intensive workshop for contest winners is one of the most broad-based and enlightening of its kind. The fact that some of the same articles by L. Ron Hubbard were applicable to both the writers and illustrators' workshops demonstrates their flexibility, broadness, and scope. I know this program is effective because it worked for me. That phone call telling me I had won was the first time in my life that it seemed possible I would achieve my long-cherished dream. I think this contest has done more to help new writers achieve their dreams than anything that has come before. I know it gave me a huge push. The impact of this contest program on the careers of promising illustrators is immeasurable. One of the most important things that a successful professional can do in any field of human endeavor is to help train the next generation of workers, be they writers, artists, engineers, or scientists. The work I have done here is part of my own way of paying back, and I know I am not alone in looking at it that way. I am honored to have participated. I wish the contest long life and the winners all the success they deserve. Writers of the Future simply is the best way to launch a career. It's one of the forces that keeps science fiction alive. We do not claim these writers would be unknown if it were not for us. We do claim that we found them and gave them a platform, in some cases years before anyone else would have. And we will continue to do so, finding new names each year to join with the old. That was L. Ron Hubbard's plan, and it is a good one.
Please welcome our Mistress of Ceremonies, Executive Director of Fiction Affairs for Author Services, the Literary Agency of L. Ron Hubbard, Ms. Gunhild Jacobs.
Thank you very much. On behalf of everyone at Author Services and Galaxy Press, the publisher of the Writers of the Future anthology, let me welcome each and every one of you as we pay tribute to the Writers and Illustrators of the Future 2013 contest winners. I want to extend a special acknowledgement to the anchor and backbone of these contests, our Blue Ribbon panel of judges. It is with their vision of the future and the greatness of their hearts that they contribute to the discovery of the next generation of imaginative storytellers and illustrators. They not only select our winners, but honor those winners in person and annually participate in our workshops, paying forward with their hard-earned experience. The impressive array of past and present judges make the contest what it is today. The Writers of the Future judges are Kevin J. Anderson, Dr. Doug Beeson, Dr. Gregory Benford, Algis Budrys, Orson Scott Card, Hal Clement, Eric Flint, Brian Herbert, Frank Herbert, Nina Kierke Hoffman, Dr. Yodi Kondo, Anne McCaffrey, Todd McCaffrey, Rebecca Mesta, C.L. Moore, Larry Niven, Andrew Norton, Frederick Pohl, Dr. Jerry Purnell, Tim Powers, Mike Resnick, Christine Catherine Rush, Robert J. Sawyer, Charles Sheffield, Robert Silverberg, Dean Wesley Smith, Theodore Sturgeon, K.D. Wentworth, Sean Williams, Jack Williamson, Dave Wolverton, and Roger Zelazny. And the judges for the Illustrators of the Future contest are Ed Cartier, Robert Castillo, Vincent D. Fate, Diane and Leo Dillon, Dave Dorman, Bob Eggleton, Will Eisner, Frank Fazetta, Frank Kelly Fries, Laura Brody and Fries Baraha, Stephen Hickman, Jack Kirby, Paul Lear, Ron Lindan, Val Leakey Lindan, Stefan Martinier, Gary Meyer, Judith Miller, Sean Giroux Mobius, Cliff Nielsen, Sergei Poyakov, Sean Tan, H.R. Van Dongen, and Stephen Yule. Now, will those judges who are with us tonight please stand up to be acknowledged? I would additionally like to acknowledge several distinguished guests who are joining us as award presenters. Please hold your applause until all are announced. Nancy Cartwright is a film and television actress and voice artist, best known as the voice of Bart Simpson on television's longest-running scripted show, The Simpsons. Award-winning film and television actress Marisol Nichols has starred in 7 network television series for NBC, CBS, ABC, and Fox. Aramis Knight is a film and television actor who plays the role of Bean in the upcoming feature film Ender's Game, releasing in November. Kylan Rambo is also a film and television actor who can be seen in The First Family. Kylan is also in the Ender's Game film playing the character Dink. And singer, songwriter, and model Kimberly Locke from American Idol Season 2 co-wrote the opening number she just performed for you. Let's give them all a warm welcome. We are here tonight to introduce a new generation of artists to the world, many of whom will follow in the footsteps of our past winners and go on to have professional and highly successful careers. After nearly 3 decades of discovering and fostering over 600 artists and writers, the results of the contest grow exponentially. 2012 was no exception. We had another banner year in the epic saga of the mainstay and success of this, the American Idol of writers and illustrators. Immediately after last year's award ceremony, we had national and international media to announce our winners and introduce them into the world of professional artists and writers. The media covered the full range, from newspaper print and internet articles to podcasts, radio interviews, and TV broadcasts in Canada, the United States, China, Poland, and Australia. Finally, and if only to highlight the value of the contest, the L. Ron Hubbard Presents Writers of the Future Anthology Volume 28 was awarded the International Book Award for Best Short Story Fiction, and Publishers Weekly capped its review of this volume with, "The future is in good hands." Following is but a fraction of all past winner accomplishments in 2012. Scott Frederick Hargrave, 2011 Illustrator winner, illustrated the book Indiana Horror. 2001 Illustrator winner Dwayne Harris illustrated 3 published graphic novels and authored 1. Robert Castillo, Volume 24 winner and already in the Illustrators of the Future Hall of Fame as a venerable judge, was storyboard artist on the Anger Management and the Odessa TV series, as well as on upcoming movies Love Orchard, The Angriest Man in Brooklyn, and Black Nativity. James Galindo, also illustrator winner in Volume 24, was featured in Southwest Art, as well as American Artist. Fiona Meng of last year's contest, Omar Rayan, and Sean Tan, both of Volume 8, were all featured in Spectrum, the year's best fantasy illustrations. Winner of 2010, Tyler Carter, was a designer on the 20th Century Fox movies Ice Age, Continental Drift, and the upcoming Epic. Sean Tan, Hugo winner, Academy Award winner, and a contest judge, also published another 3 books in 2012 and won the Locus Best Artist Award. On the writer's side, last year's winner, Tom Doyle, sold his novel, American Craftsman, and Scott T. Barnes is releasing his first hardcover book this month. 2010 winner Jason Fisher from Down Under sold and published a novel. 2006 winner David Sackmister published six novels, including one audiobook this past year. From Volume 27, Richard Johnson won the Jim Bain Memorial Writing Contest in 2012, and Patrick O'Sullivan just won the 2013 contest. Heather McDougall, Volume 25 winner, published her book, Songs for a Machine Age, at the end of 2012. And Kelly McCullough of Volume 17 released Volumes 2 and 3 of his Fallen Blade series. John Williams published the second volume in the Trouble Twisters books. Nancy Farmer and Joe Beverly of 1987 both had paperback editions released of their successful hardcover titles, The Island of the Blessed and Tempting Fortune, respectively. Paula R. Stiles published The Mighty Quinn, and Aliette de Bodard published On a Red Station Drifting and the Obsidian and Blood omnibus of her three Aztec noir novels based on her Writers of the Future winning story in 2007. Aliette has also been nominated for the British Science Fiction Association Award for her short story Immersion. Diana Rowland from 2006 published one paperback and three audiobooks. Eric Ritchie, 2001 winner, won four short story contests and published six short stories and two novels. Karen Joy Fowler from Volume 2 and Ken Liu from Volume 19 were both nominated in the World Fantasy Short Story category. The list of 2012 Nebula Award nominees had five Writers of the Future alumni listed: Carolyn Eves Gilman, Ken Liu, Brad R. Torgerson, Tom Crosshill, and Aliette de Bodard. In the Hugo Awards, we had four finalists: Jim C. Hines, Carolyn Eves Gilman, Brad R. Torgerson, and Ken Liu. Jim C. Hines won the coveted Hugo Award for Best Fan Writer, and Ken Liu's celebrated story, The Paper Menagerie, won all three, the Hugo, the Nebula, and the World Fantasy Award. David Farland, also known as Dave Wolverton, won no less than seven awards for his novel, Nightingale, including Hollywood Book Festival Award for Best Book of the Year. Nnedi Okorafor was nominated for the Andrew Norton Award, and Brad R. Torgerson, the John W. Campbell Award for Best New Writer. What you just heard is far from the complete rundown of all the published works and accomplishments in this past year. Now add to that the past 28 years of accomplishments, and this is where we stand as of 2013. All told, our 276 past Illustrator winners have produced over 4,500 illustrations, 356 comic books, graced 594 books and albums with their art, and visually contributed to 36 TV series and 46 major movies. That is not to mention the over 1.3 million art prints that are in circulation from those winners. Our 348 writer winners have published 838 novels and nearly 4,000 short stories. They have produced 27 New York Times bestsellers, and their work have sold over 50 million copies. Finally, our illustrator and writer winners have gone on to take every significant award in the science fiction and fantasy universe, including the Hugo, Nebula, Astrid Lindgren Memorial Award, Emmy, and even the Oscar graces our roster of winners. While in total, they've been recognized by 60 major award committees world over. So there you have it. Almost three decades of discovering and fostering artists and writers and indelibly making a mark on this culture. As each year passes, the contest administration itself also undergoes changes and growth. This year, we are sad to say goodbye to illustrator judge Leo Dillon, who passed away. Leo had been illustrating for over 50 years, with his work gracing many children's books and publications. We were honored to have him serve as a judge for 14 of those 50 years, inspiring countless new artists, paying forward a full lifetime of wisdom and vision. Katie Wentworth, herself a contest winner in 1988, a contest judge since 2000, the coordinating judge for the writing contest, and editor of the anthology, also passed away. A prolific short story writer, novelist, and educator, she was loved by everyone whose lives she touched. And she touched many, not only as a professional author, but also as the first reader of tens of thousands of entries to the contest in her 8 years as the coordinating judge. As we know, endings precede new beginnings. So let us now first welcome our new coordinating judge for the writer contest, Dave Wolverton. Dave was the Writers of the Future Grand Prize winner of 1986, became a multiple New York Times best-selling science fiction and fantasy author, and joined the judging panel in 1991. He also served as our coordinating judge during much of the 1990s. As such, Dave is now the first reader for story submissions and forwards the best entries to the other judges. He also edits the annual anthology and teaches the writing workshop. We are very grateful to have him on board again. His compassion and dedication to forward the legacy of the writing contest is deeply appreciated. Dave, please stand up and let's all give him another warm welcome as the Writers of the Future coordinating judge. Next, we added two stellar artists to our panel of judges. For the Illustrators of the Future contest, we are honored to now have Larry Elmore among us. Larry is well known for his work as a fantasy artist for Dungeons & Dragons. He has worked on Dragonlance and done artwork for dozens of magazines and book covers, and he is also a published author. Our fantastic new Writers of the Future judge is Nnedi Okorafor, an American-born author with roots in Nigeria. A Writers of the Future published finalist in 2002, she went on to publish prolifically and win dozens of honors, including the 2011 World Fantasy Award for Best Novel with her book, Who Fears Death? Please extend another warm welcome to our two new judges, Larry Elmore and Nnedi Okorafor. L. Ron Hubbard was, as he himself stated, first and foremost a writer with a lifelong vision and passion for the arts. He founded the Writers of the Future contest in 1983 to help discover and nurture new writers. From the very first, the mission of the contest was clear: to not only inspire authors, but to help them get well on the path to becoming professionals. And that help soon became what is now known as a most intensive week of workshops that set a standard by which others are measured. The Writers' Workshop is held in the L. Ron Hubbard Library and helmed by contest judge and lead instructor Tim Powers, who has now been joined by our newly appointed coordinating judge, Dave Wolverton. There, Writers of the Future winners acquire basics of technique as taught by our instructors, drawing from L. Ron Hubbard essays on the craft. They are also given priceless wisdom and advice from attending judges. The writers then walk the literary footsteps of searching for research in the Los Angeles Public Library, leading them down the path of true storytelling. Talking to strangers on Hollywood Boulevard, where there is no shortage of colorful characters to gather story ideas from. Then writing a story in record time, that is, with a 24-hour deadline, a feat unheard of for most beginning writers, something that they usually spend weeks or months working on. This boot camp approach gives them subjective reality on that time-honored tradition of meeting a deadline, a lesson that will serve them well for the rest of their career. The Illustrators of the Future workshop is likewise led by judges and top professionals in the field of art and illustration. In addition to instructional and practical seminars, winning artists also study essays written by L. Ron Hubbard on the subject of art. Illustrator portfolios are professionally critiqued by judges and workshop instructors, who are carefully chosen for their ability to give constructive direction. The workshops lead up to the big moment when illustrators present their story art to the writers for the first time, a moment when authors and artists connect in ways not seen since the golden age of science fiction. And so the two contests dovetail, and professional as well as personal bonds are forged to bring about a new and better future through the written and visual arts. Winners are next taken on a tour of the printing plant where they view their works literally rolling off the presses. And yes, that too is a moment to remember for a lifetime. And truthfully, it's a moment most writers, even the greatest names of modern literature, rarely experience. It all then culminates with the Gala Awards celebration, which I don't need to cover any further as you are all right here, right now. Quite apart from all else the founder of the contest accomplished, L. Ron Hubbard was himself an artist. He studied and examined the subject of art to resolve questions philosophers and critics had long pondered, including the role of art in our culture. His all-encompassing statement on the matter follows and says it all. The elevation of a culture can be measured directly by the numbers of its people working in the field of aesthetics. Because the artist deals in future realities, he always seeks improvements or changes in the existing reality. This makes the artist inevitably and invariably a rebel against the status quo. The artist, day by day, by postulating the new realities of the future, accomplishes peaceful revolution. L. Ron Hubbard started his professional writing career at 23 years of age, hammering out popular fiction tales in every genre in a 44th New York Street hotel at 90 words a minute. These span from action-adventure to mystery, westerns, and of course the genres that he eventually became most known for, fantasy and science fiction. Writing under his own and 15 different pen names, he very quickly gained experience as a writer and would altogether publish over 230 short stories and novels. And soon he was the president of the New York chapter of the American Fiction Guild. It was then he took it upon himself to mentor aspiring writers, and he consequently wrote multiple instructional essays on the subject of writing. These were originally published in writer magazines of the day, such as Author and Journalist and Writer's Review. Today, we also include one of the essays in each of the annual Writers of the Future anthologies. And as earlier covered, they are an integral part of the Writers of the Future workshops. There is Manuscript Factory, in which Ron gives a candid and enlightening essay on how the potence of economics is just as applicable to this business of writing as it is to selling goods. The articles are as relevant to aspiring writers of all genres now as they were when they were originally written and published. Then there is Circulate, for a writer to circulate among strangers to conceive his story and addressing the point that sitting around bewailing a writer's lot is a very poor method of creation. Finally, there is Story Vitality, written in the name of turning rejection slips into acceptance checks and a definitive word on writing from experience. There are more, and as Ron elsewhere termed it, borrowing from the bank of the world in ideas and knowledge and experience. That is, the writer who has drawn much from the world will find that his mind is filled with material that can be used to make the payments. The more the writer throws himself into debt, the more he will have with which to repay. And so it was that Mr. Hubbard, as a young man and before the advent of commercial flight, crossed the Pacific Ocean twice. It was during his travels in the Orient that he lived many an adventure, such as shopping at the thieves' market in Peking and traveling to the northern part of China, sleeping with Mongolian bandits. While enrolled at the George Washington University as a student of civil engineering, he studied atomic and molecular principles as well as Einstein's theory of relativity. He also went gold prospecting in a six-month period in 1932 when he led a mining crew on the first complete West Indies mineralogical expedition to Puerto Rico. And finally, in the dawn of aviation, Mr. Hubbard went from flying glider planes in West Virginia to soaring with test pilots at the Boeing experimental plant in Seattle. And if ever the well ran dry from former adventures, there was always the next horizon. As you will see in this short film in which L. Ron Hubbard describes how he lived the stories he wrote.
I used to want to go out and research what I was writing about. Everybody that was connected with me at that time thought this was a horrible thing for me to do. course, you must realize that when I did this sort of thing, I would turn up 3, 4, 6 weeks later with nothing left of my wardrobe but a pair of gum boots and some old corduroy pants, you know. Stubble a beard. I'd gone out and lived the part, you know. I'd be in a remarkably secondhand condition, broken fingernails and all that sort of thing. If you're going to write a story about logging, well, you better get in and log, man. You better get in and log. You go down and sign up on the logging crew. You know, and you decide you know all about being a sawyer now. You better be a feller, something of that sort. So you tell some tall tales. You have to be awfully slippery, you know, to be able to do this, because it means you've got to acquire professional skill while walking up to the manager and then exhibit it after being hired. Makes for a quick study. They didn't like to see me do this. I'd just disappear out of ken. Of course, they'd worry about me and all that sort of thing. I'd come back with engine oil all over me, having been a stunt pilot for 7 weeks, you know. Write a story about it. It worried them, as one could see, but it was a dirty trick. I used to have a system of not writing about things I didn't know about. I think it's a fairly good maxim. I would advise it to almost anybody.
Now, to present the L. Ron Hubbard Lifetime Achievement Award, please welcome to the stage contest director, Joni Labaki.
The L. Ron Hubbard Lifetime Achievement Award is bestowed to individuals for their outstanding contributions to the fields of writing and art. It has in the past been presented to luminaries and masters, Jack Williamson, Frederick Pohl, Algis Budrys, Frank Frazetta, Anne McCaffrey, Frank Kelly Fries, Robert Silverberg, Larry Niven, Jerry Purnell, and Charles Brown. This year, we are presenting the award to a very special individual and friend. He is an astrophysicist and a science fiction author with an impressive 26 novels and 200 short stories published. He has 4 Hugo and 12 Nebula nominations, and has won 2, as well as the John W. Campbell Memorial Award. He has been a judge in the Writers of the Future contest since its inception, at that time carefully chosen to start the legacy along with a core Blue Ribbon panel of stellar authors. He was present at the famous first award ceremony in Beverly Hills in 1985, and he is present here today. For 29 years of dedicated service to discover new talent, it is now my greatest honor and privilege to bestow the L. Ron Hubbard Lifetime Achievement Award to Dr. Gregory Benford.
Thanks very much. It's always a pleasure to come up here for these grand occasions and so see so many luminaries from the literary and film world. I come from a distant foreign province, the land of reason. University physics professors are constrained by the real, perhaps too much so, and this is my night to be unreasonable. I love this contest. And a note of caution for those who attended this last week of workshops, education is what is left over after you have forgotten everything you ever learned. Use that. With me on that first panel, 29 years ago, now passed away were Alex Budrys, Ted Sturgeon, Jack Williamson, C.L. Moore, and Roger Zelazny. Stephen Golden dropped out soon afterward, and standing tall is Robert Silverberg and myself, the survivors. I've stayed on because the contest is the best single driver for new talent our genres have. In those first days, there were merely hundreds of stories. Now there are many thousands. A.J. Budrys filtered them first, then we judges pored over them in search of the best. A.J. sent me the harder SF stories, and very little fantasy, since it's not my thing. All my favorite fantasies are related to an entirely different subject. I never thought this contest would grow to such size and fame. I really didn't. The ripple effect it has caused is huge. And not just in the science fiction fantasy genres, but in our culture. By continuing to nurture new talent, and to quote good old L. Ron, who started the contest, as, quote, a means for new and budding writers to have a chance for their creative efforts to be seen and acknowledged. That's from the intro written by him for the very first anthology, by the way. It has found so many talents and helped them get into the literary and artistic stage through my long tenure on the judges panel that, well, it's just stunning, really. I didn't see it coming. Many of my colleagues in the Science Fiction Writers of America I first met on the stage of these awards. I learned early on that there is science, there is logic, there is reason, there is thought verified by experience, and then, alas, there is California. Of course, there are some connections tonight to the provinces of film and entertainment as well. For example, last year at this occasion, a friend from what I think of as Hollywood land was concerned about the Japanese nuclear accidents. And since I'm a professor of physics, he asked me a question that was bothering him. Why was plutonium, he said, if it was so dangerous, named after a Disney character? I didn't know either. I suppose that goes to an observation I made long ago about writers. They have to remain creative, and that means keeping a fresh eye on the world. That's a great benefit of being a writer. You're only young once, but, particularly in California, you can stay immature indefinitely. When I started writing while in graduate school at UC San Diego, I soon saw that a man or a woman only really learns in two ways, one by reading and the other by having smart friends. The people you meet at these occasions are among the smartest I know and the most talented and creative as well. Learn from them. So I urge you to read the book you're about to get and see. These are the writers to watch, the new ones. Their stories and the illustrations that go with them can be comic or dark. Many have sobering implications. The contest has led to many, many books, as we saw, and quite a few trees gave their lives to make them. I'm happy to see them also getting promulgated through momentarily indisposed electrons. And the writers laboring at their computers have made an even larger number of electrons terribly inconvenienced. But it's all in the best of causes. Finding the talent that keeps the realms of the fantastic and ever-expanding career is crucial. It is an honor to have served this contest since its inception, and in the spirit of the founder of the contest, pay forward to a new generation of writers who, in turn, give tomorrow a new form. Thank you very much.
Before we move on to our guest speakers, California Assemblyman for our district, Mike Gatto, wrote us a heartfelt letter saluting this year's honorees for their creative endeavors. With his letter, he presented to each of the winners an assembly certificate of recognition, congratulating them for their awards and wishing them continued success and fulfillment. This included a certificate of recognition to the contest itself that reads, "In recognition of the 29th Annual Writers and Illustrators of the Future, I congratulate L. Ron Hubbard Presents Writers and Illustrators of the Future for its everlasting support to writers and illustrators. I commend the organization's dedication to keep L. Ron Hubbard's dreams alive, to spark the imaginative artists within us all, and to provide new and budding writers and illustrators the opportunity to share their works with the 43rd Assembly District and beyond. I wish your organization many more years of success and fulfillment, and I'm looking forward to seeing the creative works for this year's and future winners." Our two guest speakers tonight will tell us that there are at least two roads that lead to the stars. The first speaker, Judd Wynn, is an explorer and scientist who, through the exploration and research into the caves of Earth, is pushing the envelope to resolve our road to the stars and back. He started out as a conservation biologist, and in the course of studying insects, bats, and any animals that call caves and the subterranean world their homes, he took his research a step further to assist humankind in making it to the stars and beyond. Judd is a passionate explorer and an Explorers Club Fellow, having flown the famed Explorers Club flag 13 times since 2008. He currently resides in Flagstaff, Arizona, where he is a cave research scientist and is a doctoral candidate in biological sciences at the Northern Arizona University. Please welcome Mr. Judd Wynn.
Thank you very much, everyone. All of you love bugs. Some of you may not be aware of that fact, but all of you love bugs. Many of you have borrowed from the entomological world and have woven it into your stories. Many of those aliens from other galaxies and planets look a lot like the bugs that you'll find in your own backyard. Even Hollywood has the bug. Numerous Hollywood movies have used insectoids as their evil alien antagonists. Recent examples include Starship Troopers, Starship Troopers Invasion, Men in Black 1 and 2, and the upcoming Ender's Game. But let's rewind to the 1979 classic film, Alien. The movie starts with that infant alien emerging from the belly of its human host. Far-fetched in the world of insects? Absolutely not. Parasitoidal wasps inflict the same carnage on their insect hosts all of the time. It's how they make a living, and it's probably happening this very minute. So here's the play-by-play. A pregnant female wasp captures an insect. She paralyzes and zombifies it with a sting to the brain. She then drags this poor animal into its death tomb and deposits her egg on the insect. Over the next several days, the larva emerges, begins to feed on its host, bores into it, and consumes it from the inside. Truth is stranger than fiction, right? Then, just like that adorable little alien baby, the juvenile wasp pops out of the carcass. And if it's a female, she will start the cycle all over again. As you can already see, we have a lot in common. You all have turned to the natural world for your ideas and inspirations, while mine are rooted in the natural world and have been expanded to Mars and beyond. I started studying caves because of my fascination with bats. Back in 2011, I had the opportunity to study a proposed tourist cave in Belize. This cave supports a tremendous roost, an estimated 250,000 bats. And the cave serves as a maternity roost, supporting mother bats and thousands of cute little hairless pups. Wow, you guys are stoked about bats. That's so awesome. I had just completed my first remote sensing course as part of my master's program, and I wanted to learn more about how to detect caves using thermal imaging from both satellites and aircraft. So I went to Belize with two objectives in mind. First, I wanted to study bats and learn more about cave bugs in a tropical rainforest. And secondly, I wanted to further develop my ideas concerning how to detect caves using thermal imaging. Well, the project was a huge success. I learned a lot about caves, and I was hooked. I knew from that moment forward that I wanted to devote my life to the study of caves. Unfortunately, the cave where I was working at was not going to be a good study site. It was within a dense jungle. And most satellite and aircraft-borne imagery need to actually see the ground. So with the closed canopy of a rainforest, this simply wasn't going to happen. Caves support some of the most sensitive ecosystems on Earth. So if we can develop a way to systematically detect caves, we can locate more caves more efficiently. Once we do this, we can then inventory the animal communities that use those caves and identify the most important caves for conservation. But first, if I was going to learn how to detect caves using thermal imaging, I had to conduct this study in a desert, or perhaps another planet, Mars. In that very moment, the nascent idea of the Earth-Mars Cave Detection Project was born. Now that we know why caves on Earth are important, why are caves on Mars so important? Well, first and perhaps most importantly, if life existed or exists on Mars, we will find that evidence underground. And this would be one of the greatest discoveries of humanity. This would shake many global worldviews to their very core and would redefine how humankind views itself in the universe. Secondly, studies suggest some caves on Mars may contain significant water ice deposits. So once we send a team to Mars, we'll certainly want to bring them back to Earth at some point. Unfortunately, our current capabilities will afford us a one-way trip. So access to significant water ice deposits would not only be required to make hydrogen fuel for that return trip, but could also be used for human consumption. Finally, because the Martian surface is blasted with violent windstorms and cosmic radiation, NASA may desire to build temporary or permanent astronaut or speleonaut bases underground. Cave entrances would provide us with that access. So with all of this information stuffed into my quiver, I assembled a team of astrophysicists and astrogeologists, and we started writing proposals. In 2005, NASA funded our proof of concept study. 2008 rolled around, and NASA funded us for 3 more years. Our objective was to study thermal behavior in the Mojave Desert of Southern California and the Atacama Desert of Northern Chile, and then relate this information to understanding how best to detect caves on Mars using thermal imaging. In 2009, a sister project was funded by NASA, and I became an associate investigator on that study to study the massive volcanic vertical pits, or pit craters, on the Big Island of Hawaii. As luck would have it, this was the best location to study caves similar to those we found on Mars. But all of this work culminated in 2011 with a mission to collect thermal imagery from a NASA aircraft in the Mojave Desert. We now have over 17,000 images from this mission, not to mention years of ground-based temperature measurements from over 20 caves on 2 continents. But a lot more work needs to be done. Accurately detecting caves using thermal imaging is only the first step to the exploration of caves on the Red Planet. Once we can do this reliably, or at least somewhat reliably, our next step would be to develop and test a rover that can actually enter a Martian cave, perhaps a robotic snake, crab, or spider. We will then need a rover that can successfully navigate the often formidable subterranean realm. Cave floors are often covered by jumbled boulders, fissures, and often have deep vertical shafts. So our robotic cave explorer will not only have to be acrobatic, but we'll also have to be able to descend into holes and perhaps even climb walls. It will have to be a robotic caver. We'll also have to figure out the payload for a stealthy, acrobatic, robotic caver. All of the instruments needed to search for the evidence of life will have to be tremendously miniaturized. I envision the entire payload fitting within a medium-sized backpack. Clearly, at this point, we've entered the science fiction realm once again. However, a dream of mine is that within my lifetime, this will become science fact. Everything that I've shared with you has taken place over the past decade. I've worked with NASA on several projects. I've studied cave ecosystems all over the world. Colleagues and I have identified nearly 50 new species of insects from the American Southwest and Easter Island. And we've been publishing science papers on all of this work. When I first embarked upon this journey, many told me that I could never make a career out of studying caves. Fortunately, I didn't listen. I honed in on what I was most passionate about, and today I'm beginning to make some significant contributions to both terrestrial and interplanetary speleology. We're all here because we're driven by the desire to do what makes us happy. We found our purpose in life, and we've pursued it with vigor. Most of us have refused to punch a time clock or work in a maze of cubicles. We're here to push the envelope. We're here to break boundaries, both scientifically and creatively. It's what we do best. For those of you receiving awards tonight, I offer to you my heartfelt congratulations. You've allowed your curiosity to ride shotgun, and you've held your dreams sacrosanct. Your diligence has indeed paid dividends, and you are setting new boundaries. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share my story with you all tonight. I hope I have given at least one of you fodder for a Martian cave bug story. Thank you very much.
Our final and keynote speaker is a hardcore engineer who is part of the team that built the Mars Curiosity rover. Brett Kennedy is currently the supervisor of the Robotic Vehicles and Manipulators Group at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena. Seeking the bleeding edge of mobile robotic applications, Brett has worked the last 15 years at JPL on diverse systems, the most immediate being the robotic arm aboard the Curiosity rover, which is currently patiently waiting out the solar conjunction on Mars. To tell you about science fiction becoming science fact, please welcome Mr. Brett Kennedy.
Thank you very much. All right, an engineer and a science fiction writer walk into a bar. The bartender looks up and he says, drinking alone again. So, clearly it's a good thing that I showed some aptitude for engineering because I was never going to make it doing stand-up. And as awful as the joke may be, it actually encompasses much that I believe to be true, that the divide between my kind of engineering and science fiction writing is not so large. It's relatively easy to find examples of people who cross that divide. However, I wanted to explore the idea a bit more as well, using the recent experiences of the Mars rover Curiosity as a touchstone. As is customary, I'd like to call on the words of a luminary to motivate. There are many good examples, but it seems particularly appropriate on the occasion of the Writers of the Future Awards to use the opening line from L. Ron Hubbard's To the Stars. Space is deep, man is small, and time is his relentless enemy. Written as they were in the nascent days of science fiction and before there was such thing as engineering fact concerning space travel, these words still ring true not just for today's science fiction writer, reader, and artist, but also for humankind and its continuing quest deeper into space. And why do I believe this to be true? I do not profess to know the original intent of those words, but as one of the wonders of writing and reading, they were able to look at all creative works through the lens of our own experience. This is how I interpret those words relative to our today, howsoever they were originally intended to dress our tomorrow. Space is deep. Simply, there is so much to explore, so much to do. And our inner space is just as rich as our outer space. All of that gives writers and engineers an effectively infinite playground. Man is small. We are small in so many ways, yet giant in others. We are physically small relative to the natural forces around us. We are also small when we stare at our feet rather than scanning the skies. We focus on our bodies, our immediate circumstances, our next day, our next paycheck. Writers and engineers must have a will to confront this tendency. We must both accommodate its reality and transcend its comfortable confines. And time is his relentless enemy. Humans are no smaller than when confronted with their allotment within the span of time. For those who wish to transcend the current boundaries of human achievement, the greatest enemy is the time with which we have to work. Again and again, we see that the well of creativity does not run dry. It is the human body or the vagaries of civilization that fails it. Therefore, there must be an urgency to see our contribution through. There is so much to do, and we must have a will and an urgency to see it through. So, let me step down off of my soapbox and give you an example from NASA's most recent foray to Mars, the Mars Science Laboratory, or Curiosity, as we call it. I offer it on behalf of the more than 4,000 men and women who have directly contributed to this mission. So as we start, I'd like to translate the legalese you see on the screen into something far more practical. It is a thank you to the American taxpayer who sees this work as a worthy investment in the country and in humankind. It is also appropriate to acknowledge the international contributions to the science instruments and the engineering elements aboard the rover. Okay, so the most obvious statement is that we sent a rover to another planet. So it is safe to say that space is now a little less deep, man is a little bigger, and time's pressure has been eluded, if only for a moment. And here is a portrait of Curiosity in its new home. Over the last 15 plus years, we have moved from a rover the size of a microwave, Sojourner, to ones the size of small dining tables, Spirit and Opportunity, to one the size of a small car. More importantly, we are shrinking Mars by sending a rover that is designed to live longer, drive further, and carry more science instrumentation than its predecessors. These capabilities will be bent upon finding evidence as to whether Mars was once habitable. To this end, Curiosity was landed in Gale Crater via a method that looked pretty Wile E. Coyote, but was the result of countless hours of design and analysis. But even at that, it yielded what we engineers call the 7 minutes of terror. Once in Gale, the rover was to investigate its environment in a new way. For the first time, we were going to drill into solid rock in order to retrieve pristine samples to feed laboratories housed within the rover itself. And with a path so smooth that it had many of us knocking superstitiously on wood, we proceeded to do just that. At the target known as John Cline, the first holes were drilled into Mars, which you see here. The main hole yielded about 14 cubic centimeters of rather unremarkable looking gray material, which was displayed in here in the scoop to Curiosity's cameras during the preparation phase. So that's about enough material to fill a teaspoon. However, it is more than enough to satisfy the appetites of the analytical instruments inside the rover. Those instruments baked and bounced those samples until they gave their secrets up as to their composition. Rather than dead red of every part of Mars that we've been able to access previously, this gray material was not only a clay mineral that would have formed in the presence of fresh water, it also held various compounds that would have been useful to life forms as we know them. That is, of course, if such life forms ever existed on Mars. Armed with this information, scientists are willing to hypothesize that the Curiosity landing site is in fact an ancient freshwater body fed by the river or stream seen in the upper left of this orbital image. This wet Mars is likely billions of years past, but the thought is as evocative of potential histories as walking the streets of a ghost town or discovering seashells on a mountaintop. But let's return to those holes and that scoop of material. What do they tell us about ourselves? First, I think it tells us much about what we hold to be important, that science clearly matters. It can help us understand our own world better by understanding how our sister planet's fate could have been so different than our own. Beyond that eminently practical application, though, I see a powerful metaphor in our efforts to literally bore into the mystery of what Mars was and how it came to be as it is. I believe that it is not only for practical reasons that we are not content to observe from afar, but instead need to send our avatars to the surface and potentially the caves of a planet to look and smell and touch and drill. We need to get dirt beneath our fingernails, even if those nails belong to our robots. Moreover, it is telling that we pursue a mystery that is as far from home and hearth as is technologically feasible at the moment. Even at the pinnacle of cold calculated science and engineering, we are curious explorers. And what of that process of flying the mission? Despite the end product, the design of a robotic system such as Curiosity is an intensely human process. As I mentioned before, the creation of such a thing is an act of human will. It is only will that can track down the million little details that differentiate a mission like this one from a smoking hole in the surface of Mars or the tragically inert sculpture littering the landscape. It is will that allows people to work for years on a project that may fail for reasons far beyond their individual control. And will without urgency is likewise nothing. It may be argued that Mars isn't going anywhere, but we are. As we reach for the stars, there is so much to do that every generation must give as much as it can for as long as it can. While individual motivations may vary, I think the will and the urgency for humankind have primarily come from the visionary storytellers and artists. Originally, it may have just been the story of what dangers and treasures lay over the hill or over the sea. Today, however, it's a question of what dangers and treasures lie on the other side of technological and scientific discovery. And that is the territory of science fiction authors. And those authors must also possess will and urgency. The will is expressed in the ability to visualize a reality that could be, learn to communicate that potential reality using the art and craft of storytelling, grab the opportunity such as the one presented through these inspiring contests, and give explorers, scientists, and engineers foolproof job security to make science fiction into fact. Thank you for that vote of future employment. The urgency for authors is expressed in the need to continue to write, injecting vibrancy into our culture by finding new insights and provoking new thoughts. It was the science fiction pioneers and greats who envisioned humans visiting the moon, diving 20,000 leagues under the sea, and traveling to the stars. Humans have been to the moon. A human has gone to the deepest point in the ocean, and humans have taken their first steps towards the stars. So, tell us, writers and artists of the future, what are we going to do next? What will motivate our will and our urgency? Is it something further, different, or more? And how will finding it show us ourselves? The future is in your minds and in your words. Thank you.
Now to the awards. Each quarter, the contest judges select the top three winners from among all the submissions received, representing the three best new authors and the three best illustrators. The writer uses words to tell a story, and the illustrator uses visual media. Each winning story is paired with a particular illustrator's style to create a collaboration of words and images that is published together in the annual Writers of the Future anthology. Now, as we present the individual achievement awards to the quarterly writer and illustrator winners, we'd like to invite you on a tour of Writers of the Future, Volume 29, including all 12 prize-winning stories and a very special finalist selected by the coordinating judge, along with the accompanying illustrations by our prize-winning artists. And this is not your typical journey. This is a journey through other times, other dimensions, and other worlds.
In The Ghost Wife of Arlington, most people fear death and avoid him. Some seek to make peace with him, but only one woman falls in love with him. To begin the awards, please welcome Writers of the Future Judge, Dr. Gregory Benford, and Illustrators of the Future Judge, Dr. Laura Brody and Fries Baraha.
Marilyn Guttridge, the author of The Ghost Wife of Arlington, was born and raised on her family farm in Oregon. The first book her mother read to her was Con Clancy's Clear and Present Danger. Wow, with me it was Down the River Road. Ever since then, she's been an avid reader. Now, as a college student, Marilyn hopes that one day her stories will capture the imagination the same way her favorite books captured hers. Please congratulate author Marilyn Guttridge.
I would like to clarify that I was an infant when my mother read that book to me. I don't think I ever thought that this story that I wrote when no doubt I was supposed to be doing homework would ever get me here, and I am completely overwhelmed. I want to thank, of course, my mom and dad, and everyone at Author Services and Galaxy Press who make this contest possible. Of course, L. Ron Hubbard, without whom it would not exist. And I want to thank the teachers at Estacada High School for everything they did for me, believing in me and encouraging me. And to those students who are still there and at small high schools like it all around the country, I just want to say that if you have even an ounce of faith in yourself, you will not be defined by the high school you went to. Thank you very much again.
Sita Chen, illustrator for The Ghost Wife of Arlington, was born in China and lived there until she was five when she moved to the United States. Sita is currently studying biochemistry and visual arts at Columbia University and hopes to start a webcomic this summer. Please congratulate artist Sita Chen.
A really good speech by Marilyn. I don't really know how to follow it up except to keep it brief and thank everybody that deserves to be thanked. Ron Hubbard, of course, for starting this, but also Joni and John and everyone else that I don't have enough time to mention who helped make it possible. And also to Marilyn for writing a story that I really liked doing the art for, you know? That made my part of it really fun and easy. So thank you, everyone.
In War Hero, some evils are so monstrous, the world needs a hero. Fortunately, we can bring him back from the dead when needed. Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge Eric Flint and Illustrators of the Future Judge Val Lindon.
Brian Trent, author of War Hero, was born in Connecticut and earned his college degrees in English and philosophy. War Hero is his second professional sale. He recently finished his second novel in a future history series. When not writing, Brian works in film. Please congratulate author Brian Trent.
We're all in the business of imagination, and this is something I've imagined for a very long time. I'd like to extend a most heartfelt thank you to the competition judges, to Galaxy Press, Author Services, to Robert J. Sawyer, your advice made this moment possible for me, to L. Ron Hubbard, making this possible for all of us, to everyone who made this week the stunning experience that it's been, Dave Wolverton, Tim Powers, Kevin J. Anderson, Mike Resnick, all my fellow winners from this year and years previous, to my girlfriend Donna for being an uncompromisingly honest reviewer of my work, to my friends, whose support over the years has been absolutely invaluable. You know who you are. Doug, Jeff, Jay, Courtney, Jack, Kristen, John, Debbie, Josh, Sarah, Shane, Sean, Ed, Shannon, Alice, Chuck, Mike, Jill, Tony, Vicky, Maria, Scott, Marty, Damon, Colin, and Jeremy. And lastly, to my family, for raising me in a household in which speculative fiction always had a place, whether as watching reruns of The Twilight Zone or reading Isaac Asimov, and who never criticized me when I was daydreaming. They knew I was working. Thank you.
Good evening. John Eno, illustrator for War Hero, is currently a critical care registered nurse, but has led a diverse life. John lives in a log cabin in the foothills of North Texas with his wife and son. He prefers blue jeans and a t-shirt to a coat and tie. John illustrates two stories in our volume, War Hero, as well as another story, Cop for a Day. Please congratulate artist John Eno.
Unlike Brian, I could not have imagined this. I wish I had the time to tell you what I've gone through the last 5 days leading up to this event. Truly amazing, incredible. Joni Labaki, John Goodwin, you and your people are amazing. I wish I had more time to talk about them. The guest speakers, amazing, incredible. Our judges, Valen, Ron, Lyndon, Steve Hickman, and the amazing Cliff Nielsen. Thank you all very much.
In 12 seconds, you will catch one last glimpse of this world before you walk into a tunnel of light. Or will you? Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge, Dr. Jerry Purnell, and Illustrators of the Future Judge, Stephen Hickman.
Good evening. Tina Gower, author of 12 Seconds, is married to her high school sweetheart and lives in Chica, California, and I took the trouble to find out that he's a computer geek like me, so. She graduated with an MA in school psychology and counseling, and then wisely turned to writing. Studied in London. Has trained guide dogs for the blind and published nonfiction articles and stories under the name Tina Smith, imaginatively. She has worked for several schools in her area, but now stays home to write and to care for her children, Isaac and Ella. And now, please congratulate Tina Gower.
How do I follow a speech by Jerry Pernelli? That was really funny. Gotta open up my speech Bible. First of all, I'd like to thank L. Ron Hubbard. Without him, none of this would be possible. I'd like to thank the judges and author services, and the fellow winners who made this week absolutely amazing. I'd like to thank my friends and family for being incredibly encouraging. And I'd like to thank my sister and brother-in-law for flying here so that they could be here tonight. I'd like to thank my husband, Tyler, who rushed my story to a 24-hour post office when the online application closed early. And I'd like to thank Martin L. Shoemaker for finding that 24-hour post office so I could get my story in on time. I have the receipt, and we got it in at 11:48 p.m., New Year's Eve. I'd like to thank the people who critiqued my story between Christmas and New Year's. Carrie English, Rebecca Birch, Dustin Adams, and Stuart Baker. I'd like to thank my artist, Luis, who did the absolutely most incredible, breathtaking, beautiful picture of a character from my story, Ava. Thank you very much.
Luis Menacho, illustrator for 12 Seconds, was born in La Paz, Bolivia, and moved to the U.S. when he was 5. He graduated from the School of Visual Arts with a bachelor's degree in illustration. Luis hopes to become a full-time illustrator and to travel the world taking pictures for his future paintings. Please congratulate artist Luis Menacho.
So I had a speech ready, but after hearing everything, it doesn't seem like it's gonna really work. And I hope it doesn't go downhill from here. But I would just like to thank Mr. Hubbard for making this amazing competition that without him, I would be home right now watching TV. My friends, my family, and my girlfriend for putting up with me when I'm painting for 12 hours at a time. Special thanks to Tina for making this amazing story, and I had so much fun illustrating it. And thank you to Joni for putting all this together, which is pretty impressive, and all the judges. Thank you.
In everything you have seen, a young girl loses her family. But she soon discovers a magical friendship leading to a spiritual awakening. Thank you. Please welcome Writers of the Future judge Mike Resnick and Illustrators of the Future presenter Kylin Rambo.
Alisa Alering, the author of Everything You Have Seen, from Pennsylvania, fell in love with books at an early age. After working as a llama handler, barista, lab rat, and life model, her fond memories of the library caused her to give up her job in public television and move to Indiana to study the intricate art of library science and become a librarian. Her Writers of the Future win is her first professional sale, but she has since sold two more stories. Please congratulate our author, Alisa Alering.
Okay, well, I had no idea that they were going to do a performance of my story, and I was going to be excited just because someone was drawing me a picture, and now somebody's brought it to life. So, wow, thank you, everyone. So I guess the first thing I want to do is start out by thanking L. Ron Hubbard for starting this contest, and to Author Services, all of the judges and returning winners, and my fellow winners for making this such an incredibly valuable week. I've had a great time, and I've learned an awful lot. This award means an incredible amount to me. Not only is it recognition of the story that I wrote, but you saw everything that was up on the screens before the awards began. All those people, all the story sales, all the books, now I'm one of them. To that end, I want to thank my mom for teaching me to read, for taking me to the library every week, and letting me check out as many books as I wanted. And for letting me read at the dinner table. I want to thank my writer friends who read my first drafts and tell me every last thing I've done wrong. I want to thank my artist, Carson, who made me a truly creepy illustration for this story. And finally, I want to thank my husband, David, who not only thinks that being a writer is a great thing to be, but believes that I have a chance at being a great writer. So thank you to him and to all of you for believing in me. Thanks.
Carson Slater, illustrator for Everything You Have Seen, grew up in Glendora, California. She took her first art class in high school and soon enrolled into a program for young artists called Ryman Arts. From there, she attended Laguna College for Art and Design for a degree in illustration and animation. She looks forward into developing her ideas into more of her own stories in the future. Please congratulate artist Carson Slater.
Wow. Okay. Thank you so much, everybody. First, I want to thank Ron Hubbard for starting this contest and all of the judges and, you know, Author Services and Galaxy Press and everybody who made this possible. I can honestly say that this week and winning this competition has changed my life forever. I know that already. Before I came here, I was sort of in a rut, and now I feel ready to take on the world. So, thank you. I would like to thank all of the judges that really helped me during this week and all of the people that I've been talking to that have encouraged me along the way. I'd like to thank Alisa for writing a truly beautiful and haunting story. And I'd like to thank all my friends and family who have encouraged and supported me along the way. Thank you so much.
In The Grand Complication, fixing clocks is hard. But when a young orphan discovers that time itself is broken, it's a job that calls for a wizard. Please welcome Writers of the Future judge Robert J. Sawyer and Illustrators of the Future presenter Aramis Knight.
Christopher Ranaga, author of The Grand Complication, was 9 when he had a dream that he would grow up to be a writer, a dream that is starting to come true. He is a graduate of Clarion West and a winner of a Bazinella Literary Award, as well as a quarterly first place finalist in the L. Ron Hubbard Writers of the Future competition. Please congratulate author Christopher Ranaga.
Wow. Let me see here. I'd like to start by actually thanking my Clarion West classmates and teachers, as well as my classmates and teachers here at Writers of the Future. You've taught me so much, and the friendships that we've made here are going to last our entire lives. I'd also like to thank my fiance Maggie, my mother and father, my sisters, my family and friends who are all watching tonight. You believed in my dream to become a writer, and it's coming true. And finally, I'd like to thank L. Ron Hubbard, who, without his incredible imagination, none of this would be possible. Thank you.
Olivia Xu, illustrator for The Grand Complication, lived in Nanjing, China for 22 years before moving to New York for graduate school in 2011. Currently, Olivia is attending the 3D animation and motion art program at Pratt Institute, but will never give up her passion for illustration. Please welcome artist Olivia Xu.
Tonight, I feel so special to be here, not only for the awards, but also as the only international student. First, I want to thank L. Ron Hubbard for making all of this happen, as well as all my wonderful judges and fellow winners to help. Like, we had such a wonderful time. It's almost like a dream for me, like a dream come true moment for me. And finally, I want to thank all my family. Actually, like, my grandfather was visiting New York last summer at the age of 83. Yeah, and we actually watched Mary Poppins together. He had such a wonderful time at the Broadway show, and I was so proud of him. And I know tonight he will be proud of me. Thank you, everybody.
When everything is illegal, it takes a special kind of nerve to become a cop for a day. Please welcome Writers of the Future judge, Dr. Doug Beeson.
Good evening. Over the years, the Writers of the Future volumes have been filled out not just with contest winners, but with finalists that our coordinating judge determined shows tremendous potential. Just two prominent finalists include one of my very good friends, Dean Wesley Smith, a published finalist in Volume 1 who has since had phenomenal success with over 100 novels published. Similarly, Joe Beverly, another friend from Volume 3, was a published finalist who has 57 novels published, 12 of them New York Times bestsellers. There are others who have gone on to greatness as well, great success and acclaim, such as our new judge, Nnedi Okorafor. Given this track record, we are proud to continue the tradition of publishing at least one finalist per year. This year's published finalist is Chrome Oxide from Los Angeles, who has created an internet persona to reflect his collection of music-related books, vinyl, CDs, DVDs, and cassettes. He has worked as an accountant, computer consultant, and recording engineer. Recently, he started writing science fiction and fantasy. Cop for a Day is his first fiction story published for a wide audience, and I can assure you it won't be his last. Please join me in congratulating the author, Chrome Oxide.
Since I'm wearing a costume, I thought I'd start off this evening by mentioning the three laws of robotics. I mean the three rules of masquerade presentations. Short is better than long, funny is better than serious, short and funny is best. I will make this short. If you want funny, you'll have to read my story. In keeping with the writer's rules of three, I will be thanking three groups of people. First, I want to thank the L. Ron Hubbard International Writers and Illustrators of the Future for providing recognition and support for beginners. Second, I'd like to thank the Orange County Science Fiction Writers Orbit for their instructions and patience that helped me reach this point. Third, I'd like to thank every person I've met and interacted with. Part of who I am and why I'm up here is because of your influence. Thank you.
In Scavengers, the small, isolated village of Goldwater is watched over by the Vulture Lady. One young woman is able to penetrate the veil of oppression. Thank you. Please welcome Writers of the Future judge Kevin J. Anderson and Illustrators of the Future presenter Nancy Cartwright.
Isn't this a great stage? Really gets the gears turning. Shannon Peavy, author of Scavengers, was born and raised near Seattle, Washington. After receiving a degree in English from Mount Holyoke College, she returned to the Pacific Northwest and began writing in earnest. When not writing, Shannon works as a horse trainer and continually attempts mastery of the piano. I also hear that she's an opera singer, but didn't want that on the teleprompter. Her first Writers of the Future win is her first published work. Please congratulate author Shannon Peavy.
That was just incredible. Before this contest, I was an unpublished writer, so my stories only existed in my head and deep, deep in the hard drive of my computer. So one of the best things about coming here is seeing this stage show and seeing the amazing illustration that James has produced for it. And I'm so thankful for the opportunity to come here and be part of such a contest with a strong and amazing history like that. So I'd like to thank L. Ron Hubbard for his generosity in starting this. I'd like to thank Author Services for all they've done this week to make us feel welcome. Also, our judges and instructors and the returning winners who just made us feel like we were at home the whole time. I'd like to thank my writing group back home, the Wordslingers near Seattle. They're always unrelenting in their opinions and very honest. I appreciate that. And most of all, I'd like to thank my family, who have been incredibly supportive, and without whom not only would I not be here, but I'm sure I wouldn't be writing at all. Thank you very much.
Good evening. James Eads, illustrator for Scavengers, is a freelance illustrator and art instructor from Orange County, California. He received his BA from California State University, Fullerton, and began his career as a public school teacher until he was quickly hired away as a graphic designer for the furniture industry. He has recently retired and is hard at work on writing and illustrating children's books. Please help me congratulate artist James Eads.
Hard to top that. This has been an absolutely wonderful experience. Now, on top of all of this, my granddaughter, Molly, is gonna think I'm the coolest papa in the world. Bart Simpson announced me? Are you kidding me? I wanted to thank my wife and my daughters, my kids, for all of the support and that encouragement to, Pop, you gotta enter, you gotta enter. And that's pretty cool. The time up here with Ron and Val, Steve, and Cliff, my buddy, it's been unbelievable. the information, the goodness, the kindness to share. Wow, this is pretty special. The L. Ron Hubbard, thank you for starting this. What a great, great opportunity to pay forward. It just says so much, and it's my turn. Wow. Joni LeBach, I don't know how you guys at the Author Services and the Galaxy Press get, it's amazing to watch them work. They're cool, they get everything all done. You go, my gosh, we've spent a whirlwind getting all this information and getting us from place to place, and we didn't lose anybody. On top of this, I met this great kid. She's wonderful. Shannon Peavy. You wrote this wonderful Scavengers. She laid out such a rich story, such a rich world. I didn't have to do any work. She just laid it out for me. She made it easy. All I had to do was draw what she said. It was cool. You know, sometimes when you go through life, a few things happen and you want to just hang on to them forever, and this is one of them. This has been a great, great time. Thank you. Thank you.
In Gonna Reach Out and Grab You, when a dead man appears in a field, it's time to call a medical examiner. But this isn't like any human seen before. Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge Dave Wolverton and Illustrators of the Future Judge Dave Dorman.
Eric Cline, author of Gonna Reach Out and Grab Ya, was born in Independence, Missouri. He holds a master's degree in English. He now lives in Maryland with his wife and dogs and writes with a passion on evenings and weekends. Please congratulate author Eric Cline.
Thank you so much for this wonderful honor. I want to first pay tribute to the great L. Ron Hubbard, author of some wonderful books, as well as the founder of this contest. I particularly recommend Fear and Final Blackout if you want to have some pretty intense experiences. I also want to thank the great folks at Author Services who have done everything from pick us up at the airport to herd us to the proper places. Joni, John, I think a whole bunch of people whose initials begin with J and then other initials as well. This week has been so wonderful, a great, great workshop, a series of workshops and training. It really has been an intense week of training for all of us. I think all of our the authors as well as the illustrators would agree with that. Thanks to Dave Wolverton, Tim Powers, and all the great guest lecturers that they brought in to discuss every aspect of the craft with us. It's really been a fantastic help. I want to thank, as the bedrock for all of this, my wonderful parents, my dad, who was born in a shack during the Depression in a small farm in Missouri, and who would read me Donald Duck comic books when I was a little kid and made me want to learn what those little bubbles with the words meant. And my mom, who took us to the library, made sure we had library cards, and even took us to thrift shops that had books for sale rather cheaply, where, at a very young age, I got my first Isaac Asimov books under his stage name of, or pen name of Paul French. That was the start of all of it. To my wonderful little sister, Laura, and her husband, and my beautiful new niece, Grace, whom I love. My sister, by the way, is a pathologist. She is the LFMD, paid tribute to at the beginning of the story. Just a little thing there. And I also want to thank my wife and although I really have enjoyed this week, I do want to come home to you and our three, we have three four-legged children. My car actually has a very bad muffler on it. And she tells me that every time a car with a bad muffler goes down the street, the dogs are running towards the door. So I don't want to torture them any longer. Thank you so much to all of you. And for everyone there, just keep on writing and keep on drawing and keep on fulfilling your dreams. Thank you so much. Thanks.
Daniel Renault, illustrator for Gonna Reach Out and Grab You, was born in Denver, Colorado, and now attends Academy of Art University in San Francisco, where he is currently studying to obtain his bachelor's in illustration. He looks eagerly forward to establishing an artistic legacy of his own. Please congratulate artist Daniel Renault.
Okay. I have to thank my family. Without them, I wouldn't be here. They've all supported me. They've stood behind me and they've inspired me through everything. Just complete loyalty, no matter how crazy I may be sometimes. I also need to thank everyone at Author Services, Galaxy Press, Joni Labaki, Epitome of Awesome. I would also like to thank my girlfriend Debbie for always standing beside me, even though I do spend an awful lot of time at that drawing desk. And I suppose I just have to say to every art teacher I've had, thanks for seeing that spark inside of me and stoking it to a full flame. And for every other teacher I've had throughout the years, this is why you can never get me to stop drawing in your class. Thank you.
In Vestigial Girl, we're already making test tube babies. What will we do with the rejects? Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge Nnedi Okorafor and Illustrators of the Future Judge Sergei Poyarkov.
Alex Wilson, author of Vestigial Girl, is a writer and actor in Carrboro, North Carolina. Last year, a dark fantasy comic he wrote won an Eagle Award, the longest running of the major comic book industry awards. And a short comedy film he co-wrote and starred in premiered at an international film festival in Germany. Please congratulate author Alex Wilson.
There's still a mint in my mouth. It was very cool of Mr. Hubbard and his friends to launch this program 29 years ago. And I am humbled and amazed at that and at the hard work and the generosity of time from the judges, the returning winners, and everyone working behind the scenes at Author Services and Galaxy Press and here at this theater. Thank you for a great week and many new friends. I am thankful for my friends. I am thankful for Jen, my wife, back in North Carolina. I'm thankful that my wife in North Carolina doesn't know about my wife in Ohio. I have the giggles. I'm thankful for Jackie, the artist on Vestigial Girl. Her work is to this story what my wife and my life are to me, better than I deserve. I'm thankful for my family, I'm thankful for my God, and I am thankful for this opportunity. Thank you.
Good evening, guys and girls. I found one very nice thing tonight, that all of the contestants said the same thing. They said, thank you, L. Ron Hubbard. I found that in the state of California, it is absolutely 100% legal for us judges to say the same thing. So I want to be the first judge who will say, thank you, L. Ron Hubbard, for everything you did for all of us and for me personally. Now, Jackie Albana, illustrator for Vestigial Girl, was born and raised in Miramar, Florida. Jackie recently started at New World School of the Arts in Miami, Florida, where she plans to study digital media in the visual arts. At New World, she hopes to create animated shorts and work on projects with fellow animation students. Please congratulate the artist Jackie Albano.
Never had to pee so much. Oh God. Oh, my handwriting's awful. I don't know how to read this either. Okay, hi. All right, first of all, I'd really love to thank the contest people in this guy. And oh, thank you. Oh God, I'm so nervous, sorry. But like everybody involved in the contest, thank you so much. All the judges, thank you. Like for Cliff, thank you for like knowing so many awesome people in school and like bringing them to like talk to us. Thank you, that was so nice. And I don't know, to like, for me, who just like started her first year of college and like took her first official art class that isn't the internet, like now, like this is just so inspirational. It makes me feel like I could do so much with my life. Thank you. Oh, I'm so happy. And to my writer, like, I really thought reading the story that you were gonna be like this short woman, but then like I found out it's this bald man. I was like, oh! Thank you though for such a good story, thank you. Sorry. But what else? Also the fellow contestants, my fellow illustrators. You guys are great. It was so nice to meet you. I want you all on Facebook and all that. I love you guys. What else? To my dad who's here, hi, thanks. My mom, thanks for helping me buy clothes. And and to my friends who are back at school. I got to see Morgan Freeman like 50 feet away. So ha ha ha, I'll see you on Tuesday. I have a lot to say. Well, okay, I don't know anymore what else to say. I guess I can't read this anymore. So thank you. Thank you so much.
In Planetary Scouts, two men are eager to explore strange new worlds. During one exploration, the senior scout must not only contend with alien creatures, but the naivete of his new apprentice. Please welcome Writers of the Future judge Tim Powers and Illustrators of the Future presenter Marisol Nichols.
Stephen Sotong, author of Planetary Scouts, started writing at 10 and continued sporadically through his working career as a radio repairman and engineering librarian. But he never did so in earnest until retirement. His short stories have been published in regional magazines, but Writers of the Future is his first national publication. Please congratulate author Stephen Sotong.
Now for the piece of paper. I'd like to thank all the judges, the former winners, and everyone else who's made this such a memorable weekend. I'd also like to thank Joshua, my illustrator, who I think understands my universe and envisions it better than I do. I'd like to thank my writing groups who help refine this story. And I want to thank my wife, who not only has to put up with cancer, but also with a husband who picked an antisocial hobby for his retirement time. I love you very much. Thanks to my family, my father, who was a high school dropout, but still read insatiably, my mother, who made sure that we all got library cards, my brother and sister, who helped teach me how to read and introduce me to science fiction, and last but not least, I'd like to thank the Kokomo Public Library, who fed the imagination of a working class boy with the books that he could never afford and made him a writer.
Joshua Meehan, illustrator for Planetary Scouts, was raised in Anchorage, Alaska, and then moved to Tucson, Arizona, where he studied fine art and illustration and pursued large-scale game and film projects, creating content and direction for production teams. Today, he works as a freelance illustrator and concept artist and looks forward to the future in such a passionate field. Please congratulate artist Joshua Meehan.
Wow, okay, I had prepared a speech, but I did not prepare for this. First of all, I have to thank L. Ron Hubbard, Author Services, Joni Labaki, you've been amazing this entire trip. To Galaxy Press and John with all of his swagger. He's a very smooth talker, I'm trying to take a few lessons. And to every one of my mentors who's helped me throughout my entire life, Betty Dye of the Art House in Anchorage, Alaska, Tony Nicoli, my high school art teacher, who always let me stay as long as I wanted, as long as I was doing my work. And to David Christiana at college, University of Arizona, who always taught me to see stories and the big picture and to make sure that no matter how well things were rendered, that I was touching people. And I would also like to thank my family and my friends, and also like to thank this whole competition for letting me come out to remember how to be human again. Thank you.
In holy days, holidays can be wondrous and heartwarming, funny or sad. Some are more marvelous than others. Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge Nina Kariki Hoffman and Illustrators of the Future Judge Cliff Nielsen.
Kodiak Julian, author of Holy Days, studied in Japan and at Reed College, where she earned a degree in English. Kodiak now lives in rural Washington State with her husband and young son. She works as an instructional coach and is currently working on a novel. Holy Days is her first published fiction. Please congratulate author Kodiak Julian.
Thank you so much. It really takes a village to create an artist, and I have so many people to thank for creating my life so far. My parents, who have been always encouraging, my extremely patient husband and our son, Ender, my The kid better grow up to be a writer, or a reader at least. My critique group from back in middle school days, Emily, Alethea, Nora, and Mimi. My very encouraging friends who have shaped me in adulthood, Miranda Lake, Jennifer Graham, Stuart Bussell. The Oricon critique group that taught me that Holy Days was indeed a story, Ed Vick, Annie Billette, and John Worsley. Also thanks the Cascade Writers Workshop, Renovation critique group, Reed College critique classes, and then just enormous thanks to the Writers of the Future Contest, ASI, to these incredible judges and instructors who have shaped us this week, and this amazing group of writers, to Aldo for his incredible illustration, and to L. Ron Hubbard for shaping the future. Thank you so much.
Aldo Katayanagi is the illustrator for Holy Days. He studied at the School of Visual Arts in New York and currently lives in Chicago, where his art often combines lighthearted and disconcerting elements that play off and redefine one another. His work has been exhibited at the Society of Illustrators. Please congratulate Aldo Katayanagi.
So Cliff has been stressing out about how to pronounce my name all day, but he did all right. I'll forgive him. So yeah, it's been a fantastic week, and I'm glad to have this opportunity to express my gratitude to all the people who made it possible. So yeah, thank you to the organizers and judges for all their hard work, and fellow contestants for sharing this experience with me. And I'll remember it fondly whenever I see this dangerous-looking object on my shelf. So thank you.
In Dream Eater, everyone experiences cravings, but one young woman discovers that she has an inherited taste for dreams. Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge Todd McCaffrey and Illustrators of the Future Judge Larry Elmore.
The author of Dream Eater, Andrea Stewart, was born in Canada and has lived in a number of states across the U.S. She now lives in California with her husband and a veritable menagerie of animals on her suburban microfarm. When she's not writing, she works as a contract analyst and paints on the side. This is her first professional sale. Please congratulate author Andrea Stewart.
Okay, that's just as heavy as it looks. I have a number of thank yous to make, and I'm so glad that I get the chance to do this. First off, I'd like to thank L. Ron Hubbard for starting this contest. Without it, I would not be here. I want to thank the people at Author Services and Galaxy Press. You guys are amazingly kind and super hardworking. I wanted to thank the judges. You guys have crammed my head full of so much information, I think it's gonna take me about 5 years to digest. I wanna thank my family. You guys are the best people that I could hope to call my relatives. And I definitely wanna thank my husband, Jeremy, for being so supportive, for cooking dinner so many nights and shooing me away and telling me, go write. To my writing groups, WordForge, Stonehenge, and the Inkbots, you guys are awesome. And this is just an incredible honor, and I'm going to do my best to live up to this. Thank you.
Lucas Durham, illustrator for Dream Eater, began his formal training at the American Academy of Art in Chicago. He His passion for the Renaissance and the Baroque school of art led him to fill out an application to study at the Florence Academy of Art. It was in Italy that he merged his interest in the classical art with modern illustration narratives. Today, Lucas works full-time as a freelance illustrator. Please congratulate the artist, Lucas Dirham.
Sorry, I gotta just soak it in for a sec. as the founder of this contest was known to say, never regret the past. Your life is in the present, and you make your own tomorrow. But I gotta say, it's so much easier to envision a bright tomorrow with the generosity that Mr. Hubbard has given. And I just want to thank Joni and the rest of Galaxy Press and Author Services for continuing his legacy. I would also like to thank my mother and my father for supporting me and helping me to pursue my dreams. My brother Josh, who was one of the models for one of those drawings. He's just my good luck charm, and every time he's in my portfolio, I just feel like I just keep moving forward. So thanks, Josh. I'd also like to thank my girlfriend, Heather, and my friend, Tom, for all the patience that they've had, for every time that we've, you know, Luke, let's go out, let's have some fun. I'm sorry, guys, I gotta continue painting. Thanks for, you know, believing in me and letting me continue. Thanks, Andrea, for such an awesome story. There are so many amazing visuals. You guys are gonna get to page 407 and you're just gonna be like, whoa. You're just gonna wanna continue reading, so check it out. yes.
In Master Bellandino's Mask, we find that there is power in choosing a persona. But once we do, we risk becoming something that we may not want to be. Please welcome Writers of the Future Judge, Larry Niven, and Illustrators of the Future Judge, Gary Meyer.
Good evening. the author of Master Ballandino's Mask, Marina Lobsteder, was born in Oregon, now lives in Arkansas with her husband. After earning a degree in history, Marina decided to write, and her husband encouraged her to jump right in. This marks Marina's third finalist story in the Writers of the Future contest, as well as her second professional publication. Please congratulate author Marina Lobsteder.
Well, first I have to thank the dancers. I didn't know they were doing that, and that was fantastic. So thank you very much. I thought, you know, first I get a fantastic color illustration done by Tiffany, who you will meet in a minute. And then I also get a dance. Isn't that fantastic? So hopefully, yes, wonderful. So I have a long list of people here to thank. Hopefully I won't leave anybody out. First, I have to thank my family, who's always been incredibly supportive. My parents raised me in a household where reading was a must and science fiction was a must. And without those things, I wouldn't be where I am today. My husband, Alex, has been incredibly supportive. When I graduated school, he was asking me, well, what do you want to do with your life? And I said, I want to write science fiction. Is that a crazy thing to do? And he said, no, and if that's what you want to do, do it now. Don't waste your time in another career that you don't love. Write. So I have to thank him. I love you. Thank you so much for that. So, and of course, then I also have to thank Mr. Hubbard for starting this contest, Author Services and Galaxy Press, all of the people who've worked so hard to put this week together, this amazing gala, all of the judges, both past and present, Katie Wentworth, gave me my first two finalists, and then David Farlin, my last one and my win, and Tim Powers has been amazing this week, teaching us at the workshop. Let's see, who else do I have here? Oh, everybody on the Writers of the Future Forum. You guys are great. And thank you so much, those of you on there who critiqued part of this story. It really did help to improve it. Who else? Oh, and my fellow winners. I can't forget you guys. Coming here, I knew I was going to meet a lot of great judges, and I really have so many amazing authors, but I didn't realize I would have such an amazing group of winners to go along with it, and now we have this everlasting bond, and it's something I wasn't expecting, but I will cherish forever. So thank you all.
Tiffany England, illustrator for Master Ballandino's Mask, works from Los Angeles doing freelance illustration and art restoration. She is a recent student of Laguna College of Art and Design, where she received her bachelor's in illustration. Her work has been shown at the Society of Illustrators student competition, as well as at galleries from coast to coast. Please congratulate artist Tiffany England.
Thank you so much for this award, and first off, this week has been a very humbling and extremely rewarding experience. I'd like to thank L. Ron Hubbard for providing this unique opportunity for writers and illustrators. I'd also like to thank everyone involved with the workshop and the ceremony that made it the success that it is. Most of all, I'd like to thank my family and friends for their endless support, because I wouldn't be here without them. This will definitely be an experience I'll never forget. Thank you.
And now, before we go on to the Grand Prize Gold Awards for the official release of Writers of the Future Anthology Volume 29, please welcome the president of Galaxy Press, Mr. John Goodwin.
Thank you. We hope we have whet your appetite for some good reading. Are you ready for the book? All right. You know that the anthology contains all the prize-winning stories and accompanying illustrations, but it contains much more than that. Since the goal of the contest is to inspire and encourage new talent to teach the craft and the business of writing and illustrating, each volume of Writers of the Future also contains insightful advice from some of our judges and influential members of the genre. It's safe to say that many of our past winners studied past volumes of the anthologies, read the essays, and absorbed the stories written by other winners. For young artists, the past volumes serve as a touchstone, a way to recognize if they're really ready for the public eye. So the anthologies themselves serve as a training tool. Authors and illustrators all over the world have studied past volumes on their own, while universities such as Cornell, Rutgers, George Washington, and Harvard have long used the annual volumes as texts in creative writing classes. In addition to all of the prize-winning stories and illustrations you've heard about tonight, this year's anthology contains The Sport of Writing by new Writers of the Future judge Nnedi Okorafor, Journey for a New Artist by new Illustrators of the Future judge Larry Elmore, and the classic article by L. Ron Hubbard, Manuscript Factory. This year we have another special release. Illustrator winners submit their final illustrations to the winning stories in color, although they are printed black and white in the anthology. To give them due credit, we have created an annual calendar with their final art pieces by month. This calendar is very unique in that it goes by our own time, the time of the future, April to April. It is now my honor and privilege to officially release the Illustrators of the Future calendar 2013, and L. Ron Hubbard presents Writers of the Future, Volume 29.
The writers and illustrators of the future present their vision. Open your eyes and look into a world of possibility. Imagine a place where nothing is beyond reason. They unleash the power of dreams and unlock the secrets of the universe. They bend time and put a new spin on the laws of physics. They show us who we are and how far we can go. Experience their vision in paperback, calendar, and enhanced ebook.
We have copies for sale with a very special for all of you attending tonight. And as is a tradition, we will have our authors and illustrators on hand to autograph their work in both the book and the calendar. Now, to culminate the evening, it's time to present the Gold Awards. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the contest director for the Writers and Illustrators of the Future, Ms. Joni Labaki.
Winning one of the quarterly prizes in the Writers and Illustrators of the Future contest is a tremendous achievement. However, each year, all of our judges review the prize-winning entries and bestow the highest honor, the Golden Brush Award, for the grand prize-winning illustrator and the Golden Pen Award for the grand prize-winning writer. It's more than just an impressive trophy. We will also present the grand prize writer and grand prize illustrator with an additional check for $5,000. And now to present the L. Ron Hubbard Illustrators of the Future Grand Prize Golden Brush Award, please welcome Miss Kimberly Locke, American Idol finalist from 2003, and Illustrators of the Future coordinating judge, Ron Lindon.
It's usually common to tell creative-type people that they should think outside the box. After all the years of this contest and the successes, we've demonstrated with the help and inspiration of Mr. Hubbard that there is no box. And so the future is ours, and these winners, everybody here tonight is a winner. And we get an opportunity for a grand prize winner. Each artist tonight has displayed extraordinary talent and commitment to their work. It requires something special to win the final spot. The Golden Brush Award is an honor further given to one winner from this amazing group of winners with an extra acknowledgement of their talent and a vote of confidence in their future.
And I have a very special red envelope. Ooh, sound effects. The Illustrators of the Future Golden Brush Award, with its fabulous trophy and grand prize check for $5,000, goes to the illustrator of Holy Days by Aldo Katayanagi.
Well, I'm shocked, I'm moved, I have no statements prepared. So, it's wonderful encouragement, motivation to continue, and needed financial breathing room, so. I suppose all I can do is thank you again very sincerely and drop this on the floor, so thank you.
To present the Writers of the Future Golden Pen Award, please welcome Brett Kennedy and Writers of the Future Coordinating Judge, Dave Wolverton.
Among our past writing winners, whether they be finalists or Gold Award winners, many have gone on to great success. Some have gone on to become bestsellers, and some have won the greatest honors in the field. Tonight's winning writers will continue that great tradition. The Golden Pen Award will give an added boost to one of our winners, and we're thrilled to present that honor now.
The Writers of the Future winner of the Golden Pen Award and grand prize check for $5,000 goes to the writer of the story. Did they give you the?
No, I don't have it. You have it? Here we go. These are award presenters of the future.
And the winner is 12 seconds, Tina Gower.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, it was quite a bet that I'd even make it up on the stage the first time, so I thought my chances would be exponentially increased that I would trip on the second time. So I'm glad I made it just on there, and now for a speech. I don't have a speech Bible with me this time, but I do definitely want to thank David Farland, who I was at the point where, man, I had so many rejections in this contest. And I decided I was time to level up, you know, and really look and see what I needed to improve. And I called up David Farland and I said, I really want to do one of your workshops. And he was very gracious and he sent me a copy of his $1 million outlines. And I was working on a story for Writers of the Future. And as I was reading through $1 million outlines, I realized I was writing the wrong story. So I put it all aside, and about a week and a half before the deadline, which is why I was so late getting it in, I started writing 12 seconds. So I got, everybody has a really fun phone call conversation, and Joni called me at a funeral. And I was sitting in the lounge in the lobby of the funeral home, and I sat down, and right there on the coffee table was a copy of Anne McGaffrey's, one of her books, and a gushing teenager who, after finding out that I loved fantasy and science fiction, told me all about how much she loved it and she wanted to be a writer. And I just kind of nodded, you know, nodded my head, and I said, I try a little too. And I didn't have much to show for it because at the time I hadn't published anything. So I generally don't introduce myself to people as a writer. But then my phone started beeping, and then my husband's phone started beeping, which usually means we're getting a phone call from our house. And my husband was a pole bearer, and after he finished his duties, he came running over to me and he said, there is a phone call from Writers of the Future. You need to call Joni back. So, and that's when I found out. You know, I'm really glad that I got to come up here a second time, because when I came up here the first time, I forgot to thank my parents. Two very amazing people who love Star Trek and Star Wars, and they made it a part of my life, and my brothers and my sister, and they taught us a lot about what it's like to fail and to come back from that. And I think that that's the most important thing, that no matter how many times you get rejected, that you keep coming back. And this is heavy. Thank you.
This concludes the 2013 L. Ron Hubbard Achievement Awards. We look forward to a new year of fantastic creations and flourishing careers for our winners, all leading up to next year's 25th anniversary for the Illustrator Contest and the 30th anniversary for the Writer Contest. To all this year's winners, you are no longer cogs in a mighty machine. You have proven that you have the imagination, the drive, and the talent to become movers and shakers and to dream the dreams that will drive our culture to new heights. And to all aspiring artists and writers out there, let this be your inspiration to keep writing, keep creating, and above all, keep dreaming. For as L. Ron Hubbard stated, without goals, hopes, ambitions, or dreams, the attainment of pleasure is nearly impossible. So please join us now for the Ebell Club reception to honor tonight's winners, past winners, and our renowned judges. The mini Curiosity and the full-size Curiosity will be on display with several rocket scientists and engineers on hand to answer any questions. Do not miss out on your chance to ask some of tomorrow's star writers and artists for their very first autographs as published professionals. From the executives and staff of Author Services and Galaxy Press, congratulations to all the winners, and thank you all for being with us tonight. See you at the club, and enjoy the rest of the celebration.